Hello, my dear friends, how are you all? Today we are going to start another new story from the book Folk Tales of Bengal, which was written by Reverend Lal Bihari Day, and the first publication of this book was done in the year 1883, and this very copy was published in the year 1912. So let's start with the next story. So first we have to dig in. What will be our next story? Let's go there then. Okay, here is the table of contents. So lastly, the last story which we read yesterday, it was The Adventures of The Man Who Wished to Be Perfect. So today we are going to start a new story, and the story is named as A Ghostly Wife. So let's start. Let's go to that story first. So it is going to be our 14th story, A Ghostly Wife. Once on a time, there lived a Brahmin who had married a wife and who lived in the same house with his mother. Near his house was a tank, on the embankment of which stood a tree, on the boards of which lived a ghost of the kind called Shakchinni, the purest form of this word is Shankachurni. Shank in the which means crunch shell, and in traditional Bengal, married women usually wear a bangle made out of shank or the crunch shell, as well as they wear another pair which is made out of prabal in the same red coral. So the thing is, it is being told that those women who died after getting widowed, that kind of, so in that ritual when they get widowed, then they had to break down that bangle made out of coral as well as the shank, crunch shell. So that's why they get that name Shankachurni. And in a colloquial language, as the word modified, it became Chinni. So let's start. One night the Brahmin's wife had occasion to go to the tank, and as she went, she brushed by a Shakchunni who stood near, on which the ghost got very angry with the woman, seized her by the throat, climbed into her tree and thrust her into a hole in the trunk. There the woman lay almost dead with fear. The ghost put on the clothes of the woman and went into the house of the Brahmin. Neither the Brahmin nor his mother had any inkling of the change. The Brahmin thought his wife returned from the tank, and the mother thought that it was her daughter-in-law. Next morning, the mother-in-law discovered some change in her daughter-in-law's. Okay, there may be one picture. Here is the ghost, the Shankachurni, the fogged structure, and here is the actual daughter-in-law or the woman. So her daughter-in-law, she knew, was continuously weak and languid, and took a long time to do the work of the house, but she had apparently become quite a different person. All of a sudden she had become very active. She now did the work of the house in an incredibly short time. Suspecting nothing, the old woman said nothing either to her son or to her daughter-in-law. On the contrary, she inly rejoiced that her daughter-in-law had turned over a new leaf. But her surprise became every day greater and greater. The cooking of the household was done in much less time than before. When the mother-in-law wanted the daughter-in-law to bring anything from the next room, it was brought in much less time than was required in walking from one room to another, to the other. The ghost, instead of going inside the next room, would stretch a long arm, for ghosts can lengthen or shorten any limb of their bodies, from the door and get the thing. One day, the old woman observed the ghost doing this. She ordered her to bring a vessel from some distance, and the ghost unconsciously stretched her hand to several yards distance and brought it in a trice. The old woman was struck with wonder at the sight. She said nothing to her, but spoke to her son. Both mother and son began to watch the ghost more narrowly. One day, the old woman knew that there was no fire in the house, and she knew also that her daughter-in-law had not gone out of doors to get it, and yet, strange to say, the hearth in the kitchen room was quite in a blaze. She went in and, to her infinite surprise, found that her daughter-in-law was not using any fuel for cooking, but had thrust into the oven her food, which was blazing brightly. The old mother told her son what she had seen, and they both concluded that the young woman in the house was not his real wife, but a she-ghost. The son witnessed those very acts of the ghost which his mother had seen. An ojha, kind of a priest who can dismantle or who can identify the ghostly premonitions, and also if somebody get possessed by them or by those supernatural beings, then they can force them so that they can leave the person. So an ojha was therefore sent for. The exorcist came and wanted in the first instance to ascertain whether the woman was a real woman or a ghost. For this purpose, he lighted a piece of turmeric and set it below the nose of the supposed woman. Now, this was an infallible test, as no ghost, whether male or female, can put up with the smell of burnt turmeric. The moment the lighted turmeric was taken near her, she screamed aloud and ran away from the room. It was now plain that she was either a ghost or a woman possessed by a ghost. The woman was caught hold of by main force and asked who she was. At first, she refused to make any disclosures, on which the ojha took up his slippers and began belaboring her with them. Then the ghost said, with a strong nasal accent, for all ghosts speak through the nose, that she was a shakchinni, that she lived on a tree by the side of the tank, that she had seized the young Brahmani and put her in the hollow of her tree because one night she had touched her, and that if any person went to the hole, the woman would be found. The woman was brought from the tree, almost dead. The ghost was again shoe-beaten, after which process, on her declaring solemnly that she would not again do any harm to the Brahman and his family, she was released from the spell of the ojha and sent away. And the wife of the Brahman recovered slowly, after which the Brahman and his wife lived many years happily together and begat many sons and daughters. Thus my story endeth, the Natiya throne withered, and so on. So the conclusion of the story is, whatever is yours righteously, you will have it. But if you can enact it in other shoes, in another person's shoe, then though how efficiently you are satisfying that role, but still it is not yours. So it is best that you keep your own role in a proficient manner without getting into some others' character or their duty or their role, unless and until you are being asked for. So be happy, be jolly, be safe and be healthy. And I'm going to end this video with the Bengali poem, which is assigned for each and every folktale, and that is Amar kothati furolo note gashti murolo keno re note muroli goru keno ghash khaye keno re goru ghash khas rakhal keno khor day na keno re rakhal khor dish na bou keno bhat day na keno re bou bhat dish na khoka keno kaande keno re khoka kaandish pipre keno kamray pipre keno kamrash kut 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 sa ta-da!